In our previous chapter of Linux for Beginners video series, we saw how to create users and groups and also saw how we can modify users and groups and associate users into different groups. Today, we are going to talk about users' security profile, in which we will look into default permission for user-created files, users' home directory, and users' password policy as well. So let's start. When you create users using user add or add user command, your system takes the default settings from either etc default and user add file, or from etc adduser.conf file, depending on which command and the distro you would use. If you are using Ubuntu and use adduser command to create users, it will work interactively to create user, group of user, home directory, along with other information about users, and the system takes default permission from adduser.conf file. In this file, many default variables are set. For example, it defines what would be the default cell for the new user, what would be the home directory location, what is the scale directory. The word scale is actually derived from the word skeleton, and the name is skeleton because when user is created, system copies some basic files from this directory to user's home directory so that the user can operate with some basic initial settings and environment. So if you check this scale directory, you will see that there are some files which will be copied over to user's home directory when user is created. So it has a bash runtime configuration file, initial profile settings for new users, and bash logout settings. If I list my home directory content, we can see that those three files were copied when user Umask was created. And you can use these files for different purpose. For example, if you want to control your terminal history, you can use .bashrc file. And if you want to control the default file permission for user, you can use .profile or .bash_profile file, depending on which file you have, and set the appropriate Umask value. So Umask is short for user file creation mode mask and defines the default value for any files or directories created by the user. If you type Umask on the shell terminal, you will see that default Umask value for that user. Most of the Linux system has either 0002 or 0022 as a default Umask value. So if you have Umask value of 0002, that means any newly created directories would have default permission of 0775 and files would have default permission of 0664. To calculate those default permission, you have to subtract the Umask value from base permission of 0777 for directory and 0666 for the files. The first bit 0 is for set UID, set GID, and sticky bit, which we talked into one of our older video, and I'll link that video on the top for your reference. Let's try to create a file and a directory. And let's see the permission of those files. So you will see that default permission for the file is 664 and for the directory is 775, which is because my Umask value is 0002. And if I subtract 0002 from 0666, then it will give 664. And if I subtract 0002 from 0777, then that will give me the default permission for the folder, which is 775. So if you want to change the Umask value for all users, you can assign Umask value inside etc profile file. And you can just simply say Umask 0022. And if you want to set this permission to individual user, then you can go to the home directory of individual users and add Umask value in this file. So you can just come here and say Umask 0022 or simply 022. Those are the same thing. And if you have bash_profile instead of .profile, you can add that value in bash_profile file. Now, if we log out and log back in, our default Umask value will be this new value 0022. Now let's look into the default permission for user's home directory, which is also defined inside etc adduser.conf file. Some distributions like Red Hat, they use etc login.def file for that purpose. But since we're using Ubuntu, let's go and check this file. So our default cell is bash cell, home directory is /home, scale directory, the first UID of any new user will be start from 1000, and this is the default permission for any new user's home directory. So if this directory mode is not set otherwise, it will use 0755 as a default mode, as a default permission. So that means by default, when a user is created, the user's home directory will be accessible to the user group and also other user as well. Now, if we change the settings to be 750 and save the file, so any new user that we create will have the 750 as a default home directory permission. Since user Umask was created originally before we made that changes, the home directory permission for user Umask is still 755. And I can go and change this permission to be 750. Let's try something before we change the permission. Let's add a new user and see why this is very important. Sudo add user guest 123, guest 123, guest user, Everything is default. So now guest user is created. And now if I go and check the default permission for user's home directory, it should be 750. Sorry, guest 750. But in my case, it was 755 because we set the default permission on this file before this one. So that means if I log into guest user can access the file inside my home directory. But since guest user has 750 permission, I cannot normally access the file inside guest user home directory. And the permission is denied because it does not have any permission for other users. No permission set for other users. So this way you can control what should be the default permission for any new user's home directory. The default permission 0755 is good if you're creating a file sharing system, but might not be appropriate for all environments and you want to go and change it to 0750 or something appropriate in your environment. Another thing you can do to tighten the user's profile is to have a strong password policy. Many successful attacks happen by using dictionary attack and brute force attack, where intruders crack your password by guessing the password. So having a password policy to enforce certain number of characters in your password is a good step to prevent such attacks from being successful. By default, Ubuntu requires a minimum password length of 6 characters and some basic checks against password complexity. And you can control this value inside /etc/pam.d/common-password file. So if you go to this line, you can define a minimum length for password. So default is 6. So let's do min equals 10. So that is minimum length of password is 10. Let's save the file. And now this setting will be applied to the users when they change their password. But if sudo user assigns or change password, this setting will not be applied to sudo users running passwd command. But we can go and try on guest user. Guest 123. So if I type passwd and current password is guest 123. But let's say new password is Linux 1234. Linux 1234. It gives me a warning that you should choose a longer password. So say Linux 12345. Linux 12345. That didn't match. Linux 12345. Let's try one more time. Guest 123 is current password and Linux 12345. Linux 12345. Now the password is updated successfully because the password length was 10 characters. And Red Hat uses etc security pwquality.conf file. And here you can define a minimum length, credit for uppercase, lowercase, and a lot of other stuff. Another step to check your user profile is to enforce password expiration setup. When we create a new user account, Ubuntu automatically set default password expiration, which you can see by typing chs-l guest. Might need sudo. Oops, log out from the guest first. Sudo chs-l guest. So you can see that the last password change for this user was today. Password never expires, password never inactive, and account also never expires. And minimum number of days between password change is 0. That means you can change it anytime. And maximum number of day is 999999, which is hundreds of years. So that means your password never expires. And number of days warning before password expires is 7 days, meaning 7 days before your password expires, it will give you a warning message. But since our password never expires, this value is kind of useless. So there are a few ways of changing these settings. You can do sudo chs and guest and enter new value. Or if you want to enter the default value, just enter. So nothing got changed. Or you can also supply those arguments in command line. Sudo chs, let's do -e expiration, 31st, 2022. And then minimum days is 5. Maximum days, let's do 90. Inactivity period, 30. And expiration warning message, 7 days for user guest. Now you see the difference between this one and this one. So password expires in 90 days, which is June 24, 2022, password inactive date, account expiration date, and number of days between the password change. So user must wait 5 days before he changes the password. And after 90 days, he or she must change the password. You can change some of these settings inside etclogin.devs file. So you can go here and change this value to be our default value for any new users. Here, you can change this maximum days, minimum days, and warning days. And you should have a policy to have this kind of settings to all new users so that their password is more controlled. And one last thing we should do is manage the SSH access to the system. Even after a user account is disabled or locked, they can still log in remotely using SSH if the user was previously set up to connect using SSH public key authentication method. If you want to learn more about SSH public key authentication method, please watch the video, which I'll link on the top of the screen. The first half of the video is theory behind SSH and encryption, but if you're only interested in setup, you can check the second half of the video only. Since SSH only needs verification of public and private key pair, it overlooks any password-related settings to grant user access to the system. And because of that, you should always check the home directory of any users that you have disabled or locked. So if there is any SSH folder, you should look for the file authorized_keys, because that is the file where it stores any client's public key information, and allow the owner of the private key of that key pair to access this system remotely. So if account is locked or disabled, you should actually remove this .sss folder, or at least rename it to something else to prevent any unauthorized access. You should also check if there's already any established SSH connection by the user who are locked or disabled. So if you do who, you will see the currently logged in users, and you can see that this user, Umes, is currently logged in from this IP address and on pseudo terminal 2. So this is an SSH connection made by user Umes from the client 172.16.10.31. And if this was unauthorized access, you should terminate the process using kill command, sudo pkill -f pts -2. So now that SSH connection is terminated. This is part of a regular audit process you should do if you're a system admin in the system. Additionally, you can also create an SSH group where you associate those users only who can log in using SSH and regularly audit those members of the group as well. So let's create one group, sudo add group. Let's say name is SSH users. And you should only add the users who are authorized to access the system using SSH terminal. So let's add user Umes to SSH users group. Let's back up this file first. Let's create a backup to the same directory. It's always good practice to create a backup. Now we have a backup, and we can actually modify this configuration file. And here you should add allow groups, and the name of the group we created is SSH users. And while we're at it, you should also make some changes here. So let's allow public key authentication method. Let's disable any root login via SSH. And we should also prohibit any users accessing SSH using username and password. So password authentication is also no. Save the file. And let's restart SSH service. So now only users who are the members of SSH users group and has been set up for public key authentication can establish an SSH connection to this server. So these are a few steps you can do to control users' security profile and also manage access to the files and system by any unauthorized users. I hope this video was helpful, and I'll come up with another video next week. Until then, take care and thanks for watching.